Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to the First Church in Sterling, where we are gathered in the spirit of Jesus, committed to creating heaven on earth. Welcome to all who call this church home and to all who need a church home and to all who call this church home already. Welcome to people from all towns and cities and states and countries. Welcome to all who want to follow Christ, who have doubts, who do not believe. Welcome to people of all ages, races, nationalities, abilities, sexualities, and gender expressions. Welcome to single, to partnered, to widowed, and to married people. Welcome to believers. Welcome to questioners. Welcome to questioning believers. Welcome to everyone. We welcome you to come as you are and to meet this God who challenges us to be more than we think we can be. We welcome you if you are not perfect, because certainly neither are we. And we know that the church at times has rejected difference and denied God's promise for itself and for others, which is why we say without reservation that you are welcome here, just as God welcomes you as a beloved child. We are especially delighted to see you here if this is your first time with us. If that's true of you, you'll find in front of you a plastic folder, and inside that plastic folder, there's information about our church that you can feel free to bring home. There's also a welcome card that we would love for you to fill out and then place in the offering plate during the offertory. Later this month, on October 29th, we'll have a coffee with the pastor for our newest people, and you are all welcome to join us during coffee hour so that you can learn more about this church, but more importantly, so we can learn more about you. Babies, children, and youth are always welcome in worship at all times. Their noises are joyful noises unto the Lord, and they remind us that the church is alive. So we never give the stink eye to young parents over the pew. Instead, we play peekaboo with your children. If you have a baby that you would like to bounce, you can do so in the aisles, you can do so in the back lobby, you can do so in this lobby outside of our sanctuary where the service is piped in, and we also have warm and loving childcare at all times in our KinderWatch room. It is free and it is excellent with our new KinderWatch coordinator. And and if you do want to bring a baby there, you can see an usher and they'll show you where it is. On Communion Sundays, our children start in their classrooms and then they come and join us in church to take communion with us at the end of our service. There are no barriers to our communion table. All are welcome. Children, youth, adults, whether you've been here before or this is your first time, whether you're baptized or not. So please know that our communion table is open to all. A couple of announcements this morning. We are talking about preparing a place for those who need our message, for strangers who are a piece of us that we do not yet know, for our guests who visit with us. And so we are wearing our name tags. So if you do not have a name tag on, please go and get one. We have name tags for you in the back. And also, it helps us when you come forward for communion, because we can say your name when we offer you the bread and the cup. I wanted to tell you that Voyagers this Thursday is at 10 a.m. in the Houghton Room and will now be led monthly by Roy Dennington. Roy, are you here? Yes. Roy, can you just wave your hand? There's Roy. This is an over 55 group of people who talk about, or who have in the past talked about aging gracefully, and now they're talking about how the scripture and sermon today connects with our lives and sharing our life's journey with each other. So if you would like to join this group, they will meet this Thursday at 10 a.m. in the Houghton Room. Barbara Dumont has led that group for, I think, over a decade, and so can we all just thank Barbara for the wonderful job that she has done creating community with our over 55s. The first community lunch of the season is this Saturday. All are welcome to attend this hearty meal, and there are openings for 9 more volunteers to ensure this lunch is successful. So if you can help for an hour or two, please see Jarita Berger. Jarita, can you wave your hand around? She's right there after church in the coffee hour. Pub Theology is on Wednesday, October 4th, so this Wednesday at 7 o'clock at the Mill. That is for everybody and anybody who wants to gather over beer or coffee to talk about God. Exactly what it sounds like. We have a really good time. We would love for you all to join us. It is at 7 o'clock, the Mill in West Boylston. Eat, Pray, Learn is back. Our first Eat, Pray, Learn of the season is October 12th. It starts at 6 o'clock. You can have dinner, and then you can learn about addiction and recovery from addiction. This is a really important topic. We'll have a panel presentation. It will be on both adolescent addiction issues and also recovery. So we would love for you to come to that. Mark your calendars for October 12th at 6 o'clock p.m. Phil Holman has an announcement today. Come on up, Phil. Phil is the chair of our outreach ministry leadership team.
Thanks, Aaron. Good morning. So the outreach sponsors a couple fundraisers each year, not only to help us with our commitment to outreach programs, but also as a way to support the church. And so we have, in May, we have what we call the Treasures of the Community Auction. And then in October, we offer a Walk on the Wild Side. And that's this brochure insert you see here. And basically what it is it's a walk that you register for either as an individual or as a family or as a group, and you take the link from the registration and you send it to friends and family through social media or any other method that you have, and you ask them to sponsor you for the 5K walk. And then the money that is raised through that, it helps First Church's operating budget. But in addition, we have three named charities this year. We have the Deacons Fund, which we think is a really important fund that helps a lot of people in the community. There's a lot of confidentiality around that, so it doesn't get promoted much, but we feel as the outreach that that's a really important part of our church. In addition, we have the Worcester Fellowship that we support. We donate to them three or four times a year. And then the final one is La Romana Mission. This year, there's a change in the leadership at the La Romana Mission, and we expect that they'll be very successful again, but we want to make sure that we support them. And so some of the people that go to La Romana have to raise money, all of the people have to raise money for their tickets, and some of the people have trouble getting that money raised. And so we want to make an offer to La Romana that if they walk on behalf of the Walk on the Wild Side, 100% of the money that those people raise will go to La Romana. Whereas in the other money that's raised, only a percentage of it is used to support the charity. So we encourage people that are going to the La Romana Mission or people who support the La Romana Mission to sign up and make sure you indicate on the sign up. There's a checkbox on the sign up. So that you can say that you want 100% of your money to go to La Romana. So that's so in the past, it's always been on a specific weekend in October, but we've run into issues with sports and et cetera, et cetera. So this year, we're having it over three weekends from October 14th to the 29th. We have four guided walks, two on the first Saturday and one each on the following Saturdays. But we encourage people to walk anytime during those two-week periods. And then on the first Sunday in December, we're going to have the Holly Berry brunch, and we're going to celebrate the success of the fundraiser at that time. One other event is happening today that's sponsored by Outreach. We have Peter McDonald, who is the director of Sunrise Assisted Living in Leominster. At 11:30 in room 2, we'll be presenting a discussion about dementia and Alzheimer. And we'd like you to try to attend that. Because there's a conflict with coffee hour, we ask you to go get your coffee, come into the room too, and we'll have food in there so you don't have to worry about missing out on coffee hour. So we encourage you to do that today at 11:30. Thank you.
Thanks, Phil. Okay, and Kate has an announcement.
Really quick. Good morning.
Just a couple things on the youth program side. Today we have a meeting for OWL, a parent meeting at 12:30. That's a change from 12 o'clock. If you're interested at all in having your child participate, please come. We are working with a couple different schedules. And also, with a fresh new staff, we are trying to make sure we know everyone who wants to get involved in anything. So there is a survey in your bulletin. It was in your bulletin also this summer, and there's also a Google form. We would love over this month to try to get as many people as possible just to fill this out, even if you don't have the bandwidth to volunteer right now, to know what you might be interested in the future. So there is a paper copy in your bulletin, and Sophia will also be in coffee hour with a computer if it is easier to just go to her and tell her your answers in the Google form. We'll also have pens. It would be a huge, huge, huge help to me and the rest of our fresh staff to know who's here and who's interested in what. So if you could do that for us this month, that would be hugely, hugely helpful. Thank you.
And now we deepen into worship by saying together our affirmation of faith, which is printed in your bulletins. In the love of truth and the spirit of Jesus, we unite for the worship of God and the service of humankind. From north and south, from east and west, we come.
God's people called to the table where simple grace nourishes us.
From down the street to across town, from single households to apartment dwellers.
God's people are called to community where we live and serve one another.
From every class, every race, every status, from little ones with sippy cups to elders with overflowing hearts.
God's people are called to witness to God's hope, to offer peace to a shattered world.
Whether now or then, death is not my end, and no heaven waits for me. Though the road seems long, I'll never walk alone, and I got all I need to sing. I know you love me, I know you found me, I know you saved me, and your grace will never fail me. And while I'm waiting, no, I'm not waiting, I know heaven lives in me.
We've been talking about preparing a place for each other and preparing a place for Christ this season. And so on this World Communion Sunday, Jesus reminds us that the kingdom of heaven is a place where there are no borders between nations, where all who are hungry are fed and all who are thirsty can drink from living water. I was a stranger and you invited me in, he said. When we prepare a place for the stranger, we invite Christ in. When we invite people of all nations to God's welcome table, we welcome Christ in because we know heaven lives in us. Please, won't you join me in a time of confession? Dear God, we have been clumsy in our relationships with each other and with you, and we have separated ourselves from each other and from you, and so we confess now these sins of our communities. God, we confess that we are a world at war, and we fight not just with guns and weapons, but with our words and ideology. We confess that even among us Christians, we separate ourselves and turn on one another. Forgive us the ways in which we use moral righteousness against each other. We've forgotten that your love is for all people in all nations, not just those who live here or agree with us or share our vision or worldview. We are sorry and we humbly repent. We know that you created us in your image, but we are only human and doing the best that we can. In the silence now, we lift up our individual prayers of confession to you.
Thank you.
beloved, please won't you rise and hear this good news? Rise up. You are loved, we are loved, despite our failure to love our enemies. We are loved even when our compassion tank is empty. We are loved through our loneliness and our bitterness and our despair and our fury. In fact, there is nothing on heaven and nothing on earth that can separate us from the love of God. And so I declare us a forgiven people. Can I get an amen? Amen. Thank you. And now may the peace of God be always with you.
Also with you.
Thank you. Please turn and greet one another with signs of Christ's peace. And now, please, won't you join us in our opening hymn number 668, For the Healing of the Nations. Be seated.
I'm very short. So we are the Davy Fakuda Popchak Duarte Diaz family, and we, I'm trying to find my notes. Okay, so you may have seen us sneak in late or had my husband assisting you in the class and in the kitchen, but here is our formal introduction. I am Debbie, this is my kind-hearted husband, Saya, and these are our two foster boys, one sitting over there, he's a little shy. Mike, Jordani and Michael. In our home, we speak a different first language. I speak English. Michael speaks Spanish. Saya grew up bilingual, speaking Japanese. And Jordani's first language is Quechua. Saya and Jordani will be reading the passage in their native languages.
I will be reading Matthew 25, 34, and 36. Utlain lire tinjereb, ikwan kep sa lin nim. O sub the sim ilesh ban lin chukwa, echonim ak lin kwam nimakwa kwan kila. Kaurisim vilcho ere chalenchak. Such tik lahik lirich or tere chani stik tere chinish banak. Kin okacha ut kinek e chukwak. Kin chakik kwe ut kinek e chukak. Kin sik kwachachnal ut kinek ul erikin. Nakmak a kwak kek e kwak. Nak kin chakher kine tenk a nak. Kin kwang sat alam koshineril chak.
マタイ25、34から36、王として私はまず右側の人たちに言います。私の父に祝福された人たちよ、さあこの世の初めからあなた方のために用意されていた御国に入りなさい。あなた方は私が空腹だった時に食べ物を与え、喉が渇いていた時に水を飲ませ、旅人だった時に家に招いてくれたからです。それにまた私が裸の時に服を与え、病気の時や牢獄にいた時には見舞ってもくれました。And, Pastor Roy.
Then the king will say to those on his right, Come, you who are blessed by my father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me.I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Let the church hear what the Spirit is saying. God is still speaking.
I told the choir that I wouldn't talk, but I'm going to talk just a little bit. I just wanted you to know that the words to the musical meditation that we're singing, if you want to follow along with this text, is hymn number 595 in your red hymnal. It's about the kingdom of God in our hearts and an inheritance of God. So if you want to follow along, 595.
absolutely beautiful to listen to the word of God and the language, two, three languages, and then the fourth language of music. Amen. On this World Communion Sunday, we are so lucky. Please, won't you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts together find their way into the heart of God this morning. Amen. I read this once from an anonymous Christian. When my son was about 5 years old, we went into a Catholic church where the smell of incense hung in the air. We were Protestants at the time. The priest came out and was talking with us about the beautiful church. My son was sniffing the air and smiling. The priest asked him what he thought of the church. "It smells holy," he replied. The priest asked him what his church smelled like. "Coffee," was his answer. To me, coffee smells like God too. And not just because it consists of magic beans that turn into a warm, comforting liquid, helping me to refrain from selling the children on Craigslist every single morning, but because the smell of coffee reminds me of preparing a place in God's house for all. It reminds me of gathering in love and hospitality, of coffee hour conversations here at this church and connections with people, which is the way that I know Christ. In Haiti, there's an expression in Creole that says, "Cooked food has no owner." This is the world through Jesus' eyes, a sense that all of it comes from God and none of it belongs to anyone. This is Jesus' mindset, a spirit of abundance and sharing and welcome. I would like to say this morning that this is not a Christian country, and I don't say that because the church is dying or because we did away with prayer in schools, like some pastors might say, or because we are a melting pot for all cultures and faiths, although all of those things are true. This is not a Christian country because our collective mindset is broke. Not just about money and resources, but also about love and welcome. We are cheapskates with all of it. To be broke-minded or to have a broke mindset means to live your life with the constant fear and acknowledgement that you don't have enough or that you will run out of something. This usually correlates to how you make and spend your money. But even deeper than that lies a fundamental fear of loss and being without. Broke mindset causes hoarding instead of sharing. Broke mindset means collecting weapons of war to protect yourself and your stuff. Broke mindset causes you to see your neighbor not as a child of the same God, but as competition for resources. Broke mindset dehumanizes immigrants and refugees. Broke mindset makes us believe that there is never enough money, never enough food, never enough resources, never enough love. This country has a broke mindset. The politicians and billionaires of the world love that we have a broke mindset because it keeps us fighting against each other instead of finding power in numbers. A scarcity mindset limits our dreams. And the people in charge don't want us dreaming. It keeps us trying and failing to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps rather than helping to lift others up out of poverty. It ensures that we see homeless children as drains on our paychecks and to rank in order who is most important to us and to God. No wonder our politicians are deeply cynical and fear-mongering. And none of us are immune to broke mindset because it is part of our culture. Even here at this church, me too. Hashtag me too. I often find myself in discussion about the unfairness of grace. As someone who runs an organization that gives a lot of money and food away,
I often find myself in prudent conversations about how to decide who is the deserving poor. That's broke mindset. The diaconate gets a request for money for hotel room or gas, and we discuss together whether they are telling the truth or if they are trying to take advantage of us. That is broke mindset. Many of us boast about giving food instead of money to the homeless, worried that they will buy drugs with it. I would argue that that's broke mindset. We say things on the internet like, share this if you believe homeless veterans deserve help before refugees. That's broke mindset. We all deserve help. We have appointed ourselves the judges of who is worthy of food, who is worthy of a home, who is worthy of money, who is worthy of this country, who is welcome at our table. America first, some Christians claim. America first is what it sounds like to worship a flag instead of Jesus. It's broke mindset. Love doesn't ask us to choose. The thing about God's grace, Jesus teaches us, is that it's limitless. Deciding who is worthy of grace is way beyond our job description. The thing about God's love is it doesn't run out, as my friend Kristen Turner likes to remind us here in church. So Jesus says we don't have to choose between refugees and homeless veterans. We don't have to choose between Democrats and Republicans. We don't have to choose between our children and other people's children. We don't have to choose between black lives and police officer lives. We don't have to choose between America and Ukraine. We don't have to choose between drug addicts and the deserving poor. We don't have to choose between the right and the left. We don't have to choose between legal immigrants or undocumented immigrants. We don't have to choose between the sick and the healthy, the rich and the poor. We don't have to choose between Christians or Jews or Muslims or Buddhists or atheists. We don't have to choose between straight people, gay people, trans or cisgender people. We don't have to choose. That's God's economy. Love doesn't run out. Love never ends. Love goes on. Love is always enough. Love wins. People who tell you otherwise are trying to sell you on a broke mindset, not on Jesus Christ. In our text from Matthew, Jesus had already privately warned his disciples of the end of the world in the verses beforehand. He says that there will be dark days ahead and that he is seated on the throne and now called King. And naming Jesus King, calling Jesus Lord, is nothing short of revolutionary, because he is the opposite of our worldly kings. And in this particular portrait of Christ the King in this chapter of Matthew, he's a little bit scary. First, he says that all nations of the world have gathered before him and praised him as King. And then Jesus says he will return and start separating the sheep and the goats, the blessed and the damned. And I left that part out of our reading today because I don't like it. I know. I'm just being honest. But that is what gets us to the passage that we read today. Come, you who are blessed by my Father, he says. Take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. And how do we know who is who? The blessed ones, he says, have demonstrated their faithfulness by loving other human beings without deciding who is worthy of that love. They take care of the poor and disadvantaged. They welcome the refugees. They heal the sick. They welcome the despised and the disabled. They give food to the hungry. They give water to the thirsty. They hang out with the wrong crowd. They love people without judging who is worthy of it, just as Jesus did in his ministry on earth. Do likewise, he said. And that's all he said. The service to the least of these concerns all people everywhere. It is a reminder that our God is a God of extravagant, wasteful grace. Unearned, unmerited, unrestrained, unconditional, unbroke love.
A church that ditches broke mindset and gets expensive with its love instead. A church that welcomes all and feeds as many as possible, who gives its money away without strings attached, that is a church worthy of the kingdom of God, a church that will grow abundantly. And it is not easy to ditch that mindset, but it's what Jesus calls us to do. So people often ask about the point of church growth. We talked about growth in our all MLT meeting, our all ministry leadership team meeting this week. We talked about, is it growth for growth's sake? For growth's sake. When we grow, we don't know everyone anymore. Do we want to grow simply because we need revenue sources for our budget? Isn't there a limit to how much we can grow when the return on investment starts to slip? Is there a magic number that we will be satisfied at? And I told them that the answer is absolutely not, because we do not grow for growth's sake. We do not grow to feed the pastor's ego. We do not grow because we look at humans and see dollar signs circling their heads. We grow because this is not a closed social club. Amen? This is a house of God, and a house for all nations, and a house for all sinners and saints, and a house for all. God reminds us that strangers are a piece of us that we do not yet know. Our reason for our very existence is growth. It's to welcome the stranger, to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to give good news to the poor. The more people, the more ways to know God. The more diverse, the more like God's kingdom. The more open to the least of these, the more open to Jesus. A church that is not growing is dying. Dying in number, dying in soul. And most importantly, dying to our very mission to gather in the spirit of Jesus and create heaven on earth. I had a coffee with the pastor this past Sunday, and one of our new people, she's here today, I'm gonna call her out. Sincere. She told me that she brings different friends, different family members, and different neighbors with her every week. And it's true, she does. She is like the best evangelist for First Church ever. And she just got here like, I don't know, a year ago, is that right? Less than a year ago. And she said that it's hard for her to get out of bed early on Sunday morning. However, when she is bringing a friend to church, she makes sure that they get here before 10 o'clock and plenty of time for the welcome statement that I say at the beginning. I get a little sick of saying this welcome statement. I've been saying it every Sunday for 10 years. My kids make fun of me. They like copy it. They sit in the front row and they like mock me the entire time. So it's good to hear this from Sincere, that welcome statement matters. She says that she wants her friends to know that we are that kind of church. She wants them to feel and know how welcome they are. Almost everyone that comes to coffee with the pastor, gay and straight, say that they come because they were looking for an open and affirming church, First Church in Sterling. Aren't you glad that you became open and affirming in 2017? That's why people are coming through your doors, straight people too. A church whose welcome is as wide as God's love is what people are looking for. This is our religion. Once I asked a child in our Sunday school what we believe, and she said, well, I think we believe that everyone is welcome. That's what we believe. And when you ask kids in confirmation what we believe as a church, they don't recite our covenant, they don't recite the Lord's Prayer. Instead, they recite that welcome statement that they've all memorized. When a confirmand last year wrote his credo, he included our entire welcome statement as his faith statement. I think that if the one thing our kids learn about Jesus is that God's house is big enough
for all of humanity to fit in, that there's room for all of God's children at that communion table, that people of all towns and cities and states and countries of all ages, races, nationalities, abilities, sexualities, and gender expressions of all shapes and sizes, of all beliefs and non-beliefs, of all faiths even. I think if the one thing our kids learn is that there is always plenty to eat and drink and no one is turned away, then that's all they really need to know about Jesus. That's all they really need to know about God's economy. Abundance, not scarcity. At our best, welcome is our religion. Feeding and clothing and housing people is our religion. Diversity is our religion. Non-judgment is our religion. Welcoming the stranger and the immigrant and refugee and the outcast is our religion. Our religion is grace. Because we are followers of Christ, we are rich, not broke. Growing, not dying, loving, not judging. Dr. Jackie Lewis says, "The first time I took communion, my mother gave me bread and said, 'This means that God will always love you.' And then she gave me the juice and she said, 'This means that God will never leave you.' The heart of the gospel. You are beloved. You belong. You are never alone." The heart of the gospel says that this extravagant, wasteful love is for everyone, the whole world. So on this World Communion Day, it is important to remember that this love extends to all nations. Prepare a place at your table, like Debbie did, for the refugee, for the homeless vet, for the stockbroker, and the child on food stamps. You don't have to choose. Love doesn't run out. You are beloved, you belong, and you are never alone. Amen. We're gonna sing ourselves into a time of prayer now. You can remain seated. We're going to sing verses 1 and 4 of hymn number 485, Diverse in Culture, Nation, Race. The prayers of our people. Hi, everyone. We're going to pray together very loudly. If you have a prayer that you would like this community to pray for you, please, won't you raise your hand and I will come around with a microphone. And after each petition, we will pray, "God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer." Please, won't you pray with me? Dear God, you connect us to the whole world, and for that we are so grateful. And we feel the prayers of the nations as well as our own, because our skies are as blue as theirs, our oceans are as blue as theirs. Hear now your people in prayer. Mary Ellen.
The organist that we had in Clinton is now at Knollwood, and it appears for his last days. And Alan and I both know him very, very well, and it's just heartbreaking.
We have so many people from that church in Clinton now join our ranks at First Church in Sterling, so let's just pray for that whole church, shall we, and for the organist?
Alan Mueller.
Alan.
Alan Mueller, Alan, whom a lot of people know.
Yes. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. Sue.
I'd like prayers for my cousin's daughter, Elizabeth, who's going through just a messy, messy divorce that's going on forever. Every day is torturous for her, and it's sapping the life out of their finances and their kids' lives. So please pray for Elizabeth.
Absolutely. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. John. I got you.
Asking for prayers of support for my granddaughter, Emily, who just started her freshman year in college in Dublin. Prayers that she find make a lot of friends and has a good time and does well in her studies.
It's so brave. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer.
Prayers for Nancy and her family as they pass along their mother, who passed away a week ago.
Nancy, tell me your mama's name.
Ethel.
We're praying for Ethel, and that her soul reaches God, that she live forever in God's love. And God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. Yeah, sincere.
Prayers for my brother-in-law's sister, Meg, who has a very aggressive form of breast cancer and is going through treatments and having a really hard time, both physically, mentally, and spiritually. Mm.
God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. Yeah. Okay. Betty.
Continued prayers for my friend's son, who will be going back into surgery next week, and just prayers that everything will go well. Yeah. Thank you.
God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. Anne.
Mine is a prayer of thanksgiving for my daughter, who at a very young age, very tragically, lost her husband. And she is now engaged to be married to an absolutely wonderful man, and we're feeling so blessed, so I just want to thank the Lord.
That's called resurrection. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. Yeah. Chris.
I'd just like to ask for prayers for our soon-to-be former foster daughter who's moving in with her grandparents today.
Grace and mercy. Yeah. Oh, so hard. Okay. Oh, Stony.
This is not lucky to be around me because it seems I always have a prayer for someone. A prayer for my childhood friend, family friend, Edward, who had a very bad stroke and can't speak yet. It's now been several weeks and cannot talk. So hopefully he gets well.
Yes. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. Christy.
Just like prayers for the remaining members of the First Congregational Church of Gardner, which was my home church before here when I lived up that way. After 235 years, this is their last Sunday.
Oh. So the Congregational Church in Gardner, of which Christy was formerly a member, is closing today. This is their last Sunday. I want to lift up prayers of grief for all of the people who are grieving former churches as they close and die. May we be a house for grief and for healing for all those people. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. I'm sorry, Christy. To those petitions, we add these. Jesus prayed that we might be one in spirit, one in mission, in union and communion with each other and with you, O God. And today, God, we confess fumblings and failures in accomplishing unity as we set aside yet another day to remind ourselves of the task. On this World Communion Sunday, give us eyes to recognize your reflection in the eyes of people everywhere. Give us a mind to accept and celebrate our differences. Give us a heart big enough to love your children everywhere. We thank you for setting a table with space for us all. We pray all this for love's sake. Amen. We are going to take an offering now. This offering that we take on Communion Sunday, we have a special offering every Communion Sunday that goes to our Deacons Fund. So if you put an offering in the envelope that is in your order of worship, that offering will go directly to the Deacons Fund. The Deacons Fund is a no questions asked, full of grace fund that goes to people who need it in the hardest times in their life. And it is true that it is quite confidential, but you can trust me when I say that it has helped people immeasurably over the years, and your offerings are gratefully given and most gratefully received.
You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. But if that light is under a bushel, it's not something kind of crucial. You've got to stay bright to be the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. But if that salt has lost its flavor, it ain't got much in its favor. You can't have that fault and be the salt of the earth. So let your light so shine before men. Let your light so shine so that they might know some kindness again. Feel fine.
Let's have some wine.
You are the city of God. You are the city of God. But if that city's on a hill, it's kind of hard to hide it well. You've got to stay pretty in the city of God. So let your light so shine before men. Let your light so shine so that they might know some kindness again. We all need help to feel fine.
Let's have some wine.
You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. But the tallest candlestick ain't much good without a wick. You've got to live right to be the light of the world.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
God for all that love has done. Praise God for these gifts. Praise God most especially for these givers. May we use all of it to create heaven on earth. Amen. You may be seated.
Friends, this is the joyful feast of unity. Christ has gathered his people around the earth to commune at this table. Across political lines and economic lines, in places of powerfully protected affluence, and among the poorest of the poor, we share a meal. remembering and celebrating the one who proved shalom possible. And so come, you from the east and you from the west, from the north and from the south, come. Come with your doubts, come with your hopes, come with your inadequacies, come with your strengths, come. For this is a table where all are invited and all are welcome.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up hearts.
Let us give thanks to God Most High.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
And let us pray. We will not find that needed justice in our apathy. We will not find that elusive wholeness with our quarreling. We will not find our hoped-for unity with our doctrines. We will not find our misplaced love with our hating. We will not find that rest we crave in our overflowing planners. We will not find the peace you offer in our well-nursed grudges. But we will find you in the brokenness of the bread and in the breaking of our hearts. We will find you when we drain the cup, refill it with our gifts, and offer it to a little child. We will find you when we squeeze closer together, making room at this table for all of your people. Help us to find you, God in community, holy in one, even as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. On the night before he died, Jesus took bread, and to his friends gathered around the table, he broke it, and he offered it to them, saying, Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Whenever you do this, remember me. When supper was over, Jesus poured wine into a shared cup, and he held it up to God and blessed it, and then offered it to his disciples, saying, Take, drink. This is my life poured out for you. Whenever you do this, remember me. This bread means that God will always love you. And this juice means that God will never leave you. Amen? Guess what else? This bread and this juice are for all of you. Every single one of you. Whether you just came in off the street today, whether you are a believer, a non-believer, or a questioning believer, whether you are baptized or not baptized, whether you are old or young, whether you are gay or straight or somewhere in between, whether you are a sinner or a saint, because we're all about 100% sinner and 100% saint. Amen? Jesus gathered his friends around the table knowing that they would deny and betray him the next morning. Doesn't that mean that you are probably welcome to this table too? Yes, exactly. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for everything is ready.
Thank you.
mercy shed, by whom the words of life were spoken, and in whose death our sins are dead. Look on the heart by sorrow broken. Look on the tears by sinners shed, and be your feast to us the token that by your grace our souls are fed. Has planted your holy name within our hearts. Knowledge and faith and life immortal, as us your Son to us impart.
Gracious God, we thank you for this meal and for all the ways you nourish us. Grow in us that we may nourish others, reaching across borderlands and divisions. May we treat all our meals as sacred and to be shared at the wide table of your beautiful world. Amen.
Amen. All right, I want everybody to come out of your pews and make a circle around the sanctuary to sing our final hymn. You have just been fed the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and you groan at the thought of making a circle with your friends in Christ. At the welcome table, no less, which is what we're going to sing. We're going to sit at the welcome table, and you do not need your hymnals for this. I will call out the words. You can just look at each other instead. All right, Jana, hit it. Ready?
We're gonna sit at the welcome table. We're gonna sit at the welcome table one of these days. Hallelujah. We're gonna sit at the welcome table. Gonna sit at the welcome table one of these days.
All kinds of people. Benediction is from Jan Richardson, a blessing for World Communion Sunday. And the table will be wide, and the welcome will be wide, and the arms will open wide to gather us in, and our hearts will open wide to receive. And we will come as children who trust there is enough. And we will come unhindered and free, and our aching will be met with bread. And our sorrow will be met with wine or grape juice. And we will open our hands to the feast without shame, and we will turn toward each other without fear, and we will give up our appetite for despair, and we will taste and know delight. And we will welcome bread for a hungering world, and we will become drink for those who thirst, and the blessed will become the blessing, and everywhere will be the feast. Amen.
Amen.
All right, one more round of welcome table. Just that last verse. You ready, Jana? Okay.
We're gonna